also looked at quite a few lectures on vertex algebras. And we have seen from the beautiful lectures of Professor Arakawa's that in order to study vertex algebras, it's very useful to take the quasi-classical limit. He was doing it by taking the equation, exponential equation, I was doing it by considering one parameter thing. And this to approach it is closely related to each other. Poisson vertex algebras, the theory of Poisson vertex algebras, is also very important in the theory of integral systems. And in the remaining two lectures, I'm going to explain how the use of proof integrability of many equations and discover actually many new equations. Let me remind you that the Poisson vertex algebra is a differential algebra, so it's an algebra with a multiplication group, commutative associative, and has a derivation p. In the vertex algebra, the derivation of the notion by t because it is called the translation of it. And it was unital, but it was not commutative or associative. It was commutative and associative up to quantum corrections, which is a p in the quasi-classical theory. So first of all, this is classical logic. And then also, it is the same differential algebra, it's the same commutative. But in addition, it also endows with the structure of a Lie conformal algebra, meaning that we had in addition a lambda bracket, which satisfies the axioms very similar to the axioms of the Lie algebra. The algebra bracket is supposed to be bilinear, and this is kind of cislinear. When you take the outside of the first place, you put minus lambda, and then you take it out from the second place, you take the plus lambda. If it's commutative, it's also maybe close to the algebra, except that if it's lambda is replaced by minus d minus lambda, and d is moved to the left, so that it's applied to some. And the Jacobi identity, which also really is basically the same as Jacobi identity, but it's a condition of the same as lambda. And then you are just dependence. Yes, and I forgot to say that due to locality, actually, the lambda bracket is polynomial. So this is the finite sum, and finally, these two operations, product and lambda bracket, are related to each other by Leibniz rules. So the first, the left Leibniz rule, which is the usual one, but the right Leibniz rule, since skew commutativity is not the usual one, the right Leibniz rule is a little more complicated. And it's error means that d is moved to the right and it's right to the left. Maybe I didn't say before this because it's not necessary to include it in the axioms because left Leibniz rule follows from the right Leibniz rule. Let's keep it in there. And it's a nice accuracy. You want that? It's okay. Derives the second Leibniz rule from the first one using skew commutativity. It's not a complete. Now, everybody knows what is a Poisson algebra, and actually Professor Arakawa used it a lot in his lectures. So, if you have a Poisson bracket on a manifold, it means that you have algebraic functions, let's say M. You choose local coordinates. And then in order to provide this algebra with the structure of Poisson algebra, one considers, say, integer to be the Poisson bracket of this coordinate function. Right? It's not just a picture of the code. And then by Leibniz rule, this extends at least to polynomials in B. To the following formula. Then with the same formula we extend it to arbitrary functions. Then obviously this satisfies the Leibniz rules, but it's not necessarily skew symmetric or satisfactory for the identity, and of course it is skew symmetric. Even when we give H is and Jacobi is equivalent to some complicated relation which says that Scholten bracket is exactly zero, but one can write explicitly what it is. I've done that. And then the matrix H is called it was some structure. And then, so we have this important formula. And then, a Hamiltonian equation. Is the following KI abelianable sub by U. Is the form vector of the Hamiltonian equation is just such that U Z equals to some function which is equal to the where H is a function for the Hamiltonian. And the same thing can be written as H applied to H of B in terms of the Poisson structure. And then, of course, it was discovered 200 years ago that many important papers, from Sloan, Valley, equations for gravity can be written in Hamiltonian form, and it is the best way to study this equation. So, this is actually a special case of what is called an evolution equation.
Is it for some function? Evolution, раз говорить на evolution, то входит на
Here, one thing of UI is depending on parameter T. But in order to study evolution only PDE, partial differential, one uses in a similar way Poisson vertex sum. So let me first say a few things about evolution equations. But even before that, I will say what kind of differential algebras we can think of. So the basic example of the algebra functions which underlies the Poisson vertex algebra is differential algebra in observation in the indeterminates U I bands. So I runs and so we think of U as function for simplicity just on one indeterminant x, so these are functions on one dimensional manifold. And one thing of UIM is the nth derivative of UI. And of course, this algebra plays a very important role in postdocs of Mayer and Arakawa, because this is this is algebra on the jet space of the L-dimensional affine space. And then an arbitrary I will call it algebra of differential functions. An extension of RL satisfying the following two axioms. First, for any function Cf or D UIM is non-zero for only finitely many, is a set of theoretical basic identities. Says that if you take the commutator partial derivative Yeah, is an extension of RP such that, if I have to say, partial derivatives still can be.
Here's the problem of two aspects.
Of course, on polynomials, partial derivatives do permit every liquid analysis. This is also immediate to check that on polynomials, this is called. This calls. And we put the basic property of the algebra functions, and this calls also for all functions. And it's a rather subtle question, which algebras algebras of algebras of differential functions. For example, you can always add some exponentials or solutions of algebraic equations, but you cannot add in the integral of u dx. If you add vi such that d of vi is equal to ui, this is not an algebra of differential functions anymore. And as people say in such cases, the locality will not hold. Namely, you cannot have both properties by adding the number. And this is not physics, but people in integral systems do all the time, but this is not really at all. It will become immediately clear why you need both properties, and you really have to be careful about having it. All right. Now, first thing to explain is this basic formula that we had for the Poisson operator. So what is the Poisson structure in the e-dimensional case? In order to explain this, let me remind you because the formula which appears in all textbooks on semi-tonic partial differential. Poisson bracket is a common thing. It is some differential operator which depends on y differential operator. It's is it HJA is a differential operator. It led to the depth function. And moreover, HJA allowed to be not only a differential operator, but also a pseudo differential. Which is a little problematic because we don't know how to apply a pseudo. But people do it all the time. I believe that this is while the operator board expansion, which I explained in my first lectures, is a kind of basic formula in the theory of vertex algebras, and more generally in the theory, in quantum field theory. This is the basic formula in the classical field theory. But of course, one has to understand what does it mean. And after thinking a lot, what it really does it really mean, you eventually, especially after hearing my lectures, would just apply to the Fourier transform. We're applying the Fourier transform.
M is quantum machine anything.
And this is easy to write down as an explicit formula because from here, by Leibniz rule, usual Leibniz rule, it follows that the bracket f of x with g of y is equal to sum df over d. And after that you substitute this expression and you integrate and after you integrate out x, you obtain the following formula. The lambda bracket given by this formula and it's also an asterisk. Is given the source, sum over ij, sum pq, is g over d, g, q, note that this formula is very similar to this to the formula for the Poisson bracket because how you pass from the infinite case to the finite case, you just put both d and lambda equals 0. If you put d and lambda equals 0, then p and q are 0, and then this formula becomes just the formula. We call it the master. As in the finite case, this formula satisfies the Leibniz rule. Then this room is just linear. Now skew symmetry, skew commutativity is equivalent to the fact that the operator H is which is this matrix J D Q Y.
is skeleton.
And Jacobi identity, it's again some complicated identity can be written as set before and ready with itself to be zero. But we will not use for this proposal.
So in other words, like in the finite dimensional case, the Poisson structure is completely determined by, in the finite dimensional case, it's just matrix whose entries are functions. And here, it is matrix whose entries are sequential. Then the basic idea how to pass from the finite dimensional to the infinite dimensional case is the following. First of all, one has to say what is the Poisson bracket. And we want it to be an honest Poisson bracket. And the basic idea, which actually originated in the beginning of solid surface, much later. So, ordinary Hamiltonian mechanics. That we should consider not as the algebra of functions, but the algebra of functions is a factor with the image. So it is not an algebra anymore, it is a vector space. Then the corresponding Poisson bracket, yes, and then we denote by the sign of integral somewhere from P. And one defines bracket in this factor space. Then it's given by a very similar formula, except, and this was really important discovery, that you have to replace partial derivatives by simulations. And it's again a nice synthesis that it depends only on the path of F in this quotient space. So one can say this. If you add T of, in other words, exercise with the composition of the operation of the unit. Then this is in the algebra, right? Honestly. And the Hamiltonian equation. integral of H.
And here again, you have to replace the part of U.
And of course, a natural question is why you do such things. And the theory of Poisson vertex algebras gives a very simple explanation of why you do such things. And the last you to apply this to the study of this Newtonian system. Now let me introduce basic notions of the theory of integral equations. Okay, first of all, let me say what is the Bolognese It is the same as in the final case, except that it's a partial differential. Partial is the equation of the form in U and T equals F, which now depends not only on U, but also on the partial derivatives. And also if U is depending on the parameter. Now, given the arbitrary differential function, let us compute how it evolves in virtue of this equation. What is the level of the heat? Of course, we use chain rule. So it is equal to summation over I of 1 over dui n times TF and after that, but we know how UI evolves. According to star, du over dt is equal to F, so it is equal to d equal to N applied to F I. And so the result is that it's equal to xf applied to f, where xf
is the following derivation. It is sum n from 1 to 1, n to 5.
This is derivation of the algebra V, which is called an evolutionary vector.
Which is an element.
From here, you see immediately that the first axiom is extremely important. It's because otherwise, the evolutionary vector field applied to arbitrary function from V will be a divergent sum, will be an infinite sum, which in general diverges. But since we assume that only finitely many of this act as non-zero, many given like function, this makes. So in our geometry, the vector fields are evolutionary. An important notion is compatibility of two equations. Equation star is called compatible with equation two star. It's the same equation except on the right you take a function g. And g again depends on the finitely many functions. Let me write g over d tau. If the corresponding flows which star defines a certain flow on the algebra V, and double star defines another T flow. That another one is tau flow. So the ones that this constant here tau. Apply to any and I must say that for me personally, it was a stumbling block. What does it mean that flows cannot? How you express it algebraically? How you possibly work with it? You think of trajectories and what does it mean that this things cannot? In fact, it's very simple. Because we have this formula about, how dt is applied to f. It's just xf applied to f. And so from this formula, it follows that it is the same as the corresponding evolutionary vector field. Which is a purely Lie algebraic condition. In fact, it's exactly a Lie algebraic condition because when we know the limits of the matrix nice attitude.
That if you take evolutionary vector field corresponding this characteristic F and another one characteristic Q, then it will be again an evolutionary vector field. This characteristic given the simple discrete form of G is equal to XF by G minus G by an encoding.
So it's again a vector. So we get a bracket.
So the V algebra. So VL, the V algebra of evolutionary vector fields, is a V algebra. Now I can say what is integrability. There are two types. Ah yes, and another terminology here is that if evolutionary vector fields come out, then each of them is called the symmetry of the other one. So, so F is symmetry of G and G is symmetry. Or as people say, if this equation has infinitely many commuting symmetries. Now, why this definition? It is because there is a Lie theorem for ordinary differential equations. It says that if ordinary differential equation U and dt equals F possesses L commuting symmetries, then it can be solved in quadratic. Of course, in the infinite dimensional case, you cannot, the number of coordinates is infinite. And that's why one says that it has infinite dimensions. So it is analog. So the origin of this definition is actually this Lie theorem.
of course, I should say exactly what Yesenin says. It should be kind of in general position. Certain Jacobians should be in zero for this theorem to hold. But for us, it really doesn't. So we have this first notion of integrability. And there has been a lot of work establishing the integrability of various equations. Partial equation. Of course, first of all, it was a KdV equation with integrability of proof today. There is a method of constructing symmetries of an equation. It's called recursion operator. But in all examples, recursion operator is a pseudo-differential operator, and you really cannot apply it. And I just don't understand the many papers which discuss the recursion operator. So I will discuss a different method using the Hamiltonian approach, which is completely rigorous, and you will see how it is. Then we shall deduce the integrability. From the stronger Newton equation, which says, I will explain the terminology that there exists infinite dimensional, there are infinite dimensions. Of course, everybody knows what is Liouville integrability. If you have a Hamiltonian equation and it has sufficiently many, one can say exactly how many integrals of motion and evolution, then this equation can be solved in quadrature. And again, when you go to the infinite dimensional, if you go to the partial differential equation, then you just replace it by these conditions that it has infinite integrals of motion. But that will give the previous definition in a short time. So I'll be talking about Hamiltonian evolution equation, which I actually wrote down. And then, this uses, so in order to connect these two integrabilities, this uses a following basic lemma. I'm stating the first general result, very simple result of Poisson vector calculus. Then we have the following well-defined plane. first one is bar equal to bar, and the second E is bar. No, E bar equals E. So the first one is this. If you take image of A and define the bracket as image of B, it's false. You take A lambda lambda equals, put lambda equals 0, and take image. And the second, the integral of A. It's the same parameter, so I don't care. Moreover, the first bracket defines a algebra bracket, one piece of the nothing but so the bar is actually an empty algebra. And the second bracket a representation of auxiliary algebra in bar. By revolutionary vector.
Excuse me, what's written? The spaces of the second bracket, is V bar times V to V.
Yes, okay. The second bracket,
but in the areas of the second,
yes.
It shouldn't be about the same stuff.
Defines a representation of the algebra V bar in the vector space V by evolutionary vector. And one can say each one, just each element in V mod DV goes to the evolutionary vector field defined by H delta integral F delta. First, let me note that this V algebra bracket on V mod DV coincides with the one which I wrote before and erased this relation theory. And so, and the corresponding Hamiltonian equation coincides. I didn't write this. Okay, so now I have to write this. And from this master formula, it follows that it's exactly the same that I wrote before the theory. And then it's equal to H, right? So we completely translated the language of Hamiltonian partial differential equations into the language of Poisson calculus. Okay, so what is the proof of this statement? The proof is completely obvious. Namely, what happens if you put lambda equals zero? Then, what? No, if you put here lambda equals zero, then you get the dA commutator of dA with P commute. So in other words, TV is the bracket with TV is zero. If you put lambda here, then you get the bracket with TV lies in TV. So in other words, it follows that TV is a two-sided idea. So the bracket from T must be zero. If you put lambda here zero, then you don't quite get specificity because it's TV makes. But if you take quotient by D, then on the right hand side you have the bracket by D minus bracket D. And finally, if you put lambda and mu equals zero, you can just usually get the data. So this is a proof that you get on T mod TV in the algebra structure. And exactly the same trivial proof says that this representation can go. So Carol, we have a homomorphism. Of the Lie algebra. So definition is the equation, the Hamiltonian PDE is called integrable, but the UVD if integral of H is contained in an infinite dimensional abelian subalgebra. Maybe I should put here a subscript A because the V algebra V bar, it depends on the lambda bracket, it depends on the Poisson structure. While the Lie algebra of evolutionary vector, I think just the Lie algebra in particular, it follows from corollary. It follows that UV integrity actually implies V integrity.
under some, for example, if H is not a term, under some yes, another remark which I forgot to mention. If, say, F, G, etc. are such that the case pointing to evolutionary vector field, can you? In other words, yeah, we can be possible. I say it on that. Yeah, we finish this. Then we say that we have a hierarchy. The first situation is GF or G1 or G1. So the solution of this hierarchy U. Now it depends on, of course, x, but on infinitely many times. So if you have an integrable equation in whatever sense, then you get not only one equation, but actually the whole hierarchy, infinite set. All that are compatible. Compatible with each other, they form an infinite hierarchy depending on infinite many times. Each of them depending on the condition. All right, so let me make a break and after the break, I will explain the how one proves integrability. Now, there is a very simple scheme for proving integrability, but it is only a scheme. There is no general theorem, except some little theorems which I will explain, that tells you that this scheme always works. But in practice, it always works, and it's a big problem of the theory to show why it works. And this is called the Lennard-Magnus scheme. It was stated in a conversation in New York sometime in the 60s and first published in his paper in 1978 by Mark. That's what we call Lennard-Magnus.
first of all, introduce
the following symmetric bilinear form.
It's simply this, that if you have F Q, you take the dot product, and then take the image, so it's some FI GI, and take its image in Q. That's obviously the symmetric bilinear form. And then note that if you take metric differential operator, you take inner product with G, then you got this equality, right? H star. The H star, everybody knows what is the adjoint differential operator. It is this on just differential operators with coefficients in B define star. The anti-involution such that star of a function is equal to itself and star of g is equal to minus. Now the basic question is why f GFG is equal to minus FDG. This is the point of star of the FDG. This is because GFG plus FDG equal to integral of g applied to fg as d is the image. But since taking integral means that you quotient out the image of g, it is. This is really very, very important to consider integrals instead of elements. And given a metric differential operator, defining the associated form like this. So f and g are functions and h is okay. F is h, f, g equals. And if h of g is skewed, the form f g is skewed. Bilinear form of H. It is only simple.
No, I can state the basic theorem.
Let h and k this scratching function. What is it? And suppose that the elements say zero, etc. Say n. Satisfy the regulation, the Lennard-Magnier regulation. Let me do not say whatever. A k applied to psi n plus 1. Then the conclusion is that the inner product between all psi m and psi n is is by that. So first, since we have to write subscript because this question may depend on the subscript. It's for k or for a. So you have two sets equalities. One, this is this metric in product post for k and another post for
k. So you don't require compatibility between the h and the k?
No, not that. Nothing, just plus q. Proof is by induction. Yeah, first of all, we may assume induction. Modulus m minus m. If it is zero, we get psi m, psi m, k or h. Is equal to negative of it because the form is symmetric, and therefore is equal to zero. Right? If the field is not a characteristic. Next. By exclusivity, we assume, so m equals n is settled, so we might assume that m is greater than n.
because if it looks for example, this machine, it will be proved by n less.
Okay, let's compute psi m. Psi m h is equal to psi m and it is zero by its inductive assumption because modulus of difference between n and n plus 1 is smaller than difference between n and n. And similarly for k. Maybe I should say why it is important, because this lemma is important since if we can prove that psi m, which are elements from v to the n, are relational derivatives of some h n, then this lemma says that h m are in evolution. It was exactly the definition of the Poisson bracket on the Lie-algebra big bar. Remember what was the Poisson bracket? Poisson bracket. Fg was h delta f delta u dot delta g. Delta u integral. But it's exactly the metric in the product between delta f delta u and delta g. So we have addressed several issues. First issue is how to construct vectors psi n which satisfies this linear map relation. And the second is how to prove that these psi n actually are variational derivatives.
The second problem is completely solved by considering certain reduced DRAM complex called the variation complex, which I will explain a little bit. The first question is really the basic question, which is not completely resolved, but there are some partial results. In all textbooks, usually one constructs these HNs, several of them, and says, etc., therefore we prove compatibility. But now the question is if it justifies the word, etc. Okay, now the question is how to construct xi-rams. For this, there is another very simple lemma. Let me call it extension lemma. How you can extend the sequence? As I said, the Linat-Magri lemma goes back to the 70s, at least. But this lemma is much more recent, so it's as elementary. And it was proved in our paper with Barakat, Pierre, and myself. It says the following. Suppose that in addition, conditions of Linat's lemma, we have the following cardinality. Xi0, etc., xi_n, which I assume to exist. And let's consider the orthogonal complement. Orthogonal complement with respect to the symmetric bilinear form. It's value symmetric. And let's assume that it lies in the image of the operator key. Then we can construct an infinite.
Do you also need K in on the generator? Do you need K in on the generator?
What is my
K? Or,
No. It's absolutely general, obviously. I can leave it as an exercise, or I can prove it. So should I prove? Okay, let me prove. first of all, it suffices to construct xi n plus 1 such that ln plus 1 holds, such that ln holds. Because after you construct it, then you have here xi n plus 1. And of course, the orthogonal complement of larger set is smaller. And if before it was in the image of K, after adding it, it is also. So it suffices just to do it. But Vallinard's lemma, or I call it LN lemma, H xi n is orthogonal to all xi m for all m from here to m. Hence, the orthogonality condition
constructed xi n plus 1 such that L capital N holds.
Okay. And I will show you on examples how to use it. For example, I will put it in the image of GDV. First of all, I want to discuss kind of the general situation, which is really very strange situation, namely about the existence of xi n satisfying the Linard smart regulation constructed with an infinite. No, before doing that, let me address this question about why these xi n's are variational derivatives, how one proves it. And for this one uses a rather non-trivial theorem. Ask the question. So far we used only that H and K as coadjuvant. We haven't been used that the Poisson structure that can satisfy Jacobi identity field. And in addition, I was asked the question, do I assume that they are compatible? I didn't use anything. But this kind of non-trivial additional conditions are used in proving that psi n is a variation trivial. Namely, there is the following theorem.
Some people call the main theorem of
its proof is straightforward, though a little long it will take to actually prove it. But you can write this in the book of Alpha. M is 7 times psi. Suppose that H and K are not only squishy-metric, but they are Poisson's graph. So the corresponding lambda bracket is defines the Poisson graph. And also suppose that H plus K this is famous condition of Magri of compatibility. And suppose that K is multiply k by an arbitrary differential operator and get 0, then k should be 0. Now suppose that you have a Lennard Magri relation in the kx n plus 1 h sub n only for two values of that, for n equals 0. So you have three functions, say 0, say 1, and say 2. And suppose that the first two are variational derivatives. 0, variational derivatives. Then the conclusion is that psi 2 is exact. I will explain probably next lecture what it means. It's a variation of form. It is sorry, close. And hence by theorem it will be proved next time. Exact. Some extension. And so the theorem says that if you know that the first two are exact, then all of them will be exact in some extension of your algebraic differential function. And therefore you get an infinite sequence of integrals of motion in involution by the Lennard lemma. Anyway, if you can construct these psi n's and h and k are Poisson structures which are compatible, and k is not degenerate, then whenever you can construct psi n's, there will be variational derivatives of some integrals. And therefore, if you can construct infinitely many psi n's, you should have infinitely many integrals. So by this theorem, you have to build the first two should be exact. But in fact, let me make a remark. Beginning with xi minus 1 equals 0. And of course, it's equal to 10 to 10 to 1. If k xi 0 is equal to 0, then the theorem suffices to have only xi 1. To have yes, only xi 1. Such that k xi 1 equal to h. And after that, you can apply the theorem, because the first step is trivial. So you have to have C functions, but the very first function was zero. And so this is the same. Okay, now a general remark. Suppose we have two compatible Gaussian structures. And consider basis size 0, 1, etc. size 0, s of the kernel. Yeah, I assume that the k is non-general, that has finite dimension. Suppose that each psi 0 I can be extended to infinity, so that Ln holds for all. So we have psi m I for m then yes, also use and also suppose assumes that over the line exact say 0 I then by the theorem then all H and I are integral. And so we constructed of course, this is something that can be extended.
an infinite set. We construct canonically an opinion about it. Corresponding to the pair of compatible bosons. But of course, in order to state this remark, I need one more lemma, which is really very easy, and so I give it as an emphasis. The question is, so we know by the previous lemmas that psi and I are in involution for given I, but why is there in involution for different I?
And this follows.
From the following kind of compatibility lemma. If let's say xi 0, if k xi 0 is equal to 0, and xi 0, etc., xi n satisfy the Martin relations, and also the psi 0 prime, etc., to infinity satisfy the Martin relations. Then they are in evolution, namely psi I psi j prime for all I and j which and this is proved, so proved just by induction on I. And so we have the following very nice picture that if you have a given algebra differential function with a compatible pair of Poisson structures, and compatibility is needed only for this theorem. Then you can construct canonically a space which infinite dimensional abelian subalgebra. The only thing to check is that the corresponding psi's are linearly independent, but this is very easy to do. I will explain next time. And therefore, you get an integrable system of equations.
Excuse me, for this lemma, also k xi prime 0 is equal to 0?
No, not necessarily. No, just this. But so if all of them begin from the kernel of k, then this lemma can be applied to all of them, and so all of them will be pairwise compatible. And this is the main method of proving integrability. In many cases, one can prove it using this extension lemma.
and I will show it how it uses in the case of KDB. In other cases, like W algebras, if you have the principal important element, then there is a method of Greenfield and Sokolov just to construct using the theory of the algebra consecutively with this HS. So you don't need this theorem from Sokolov. Then, by the general Lenard-Magri lemma, it follows that they need Balushka. And at the same time, you may still use it as a linear independent, and therefore, it's the Greenfield Sokolov. In many cases, Greenfield-Sokolov procedure can be applied for other double algebras, but unfortunately, not all of them, only under certain conditions. And it's a big open problem, just in this particular case, is it true that for all W algebras, this canonically associated space exists? For each element from the kernel, you can extend it to infinity. So this is an example.
Are there questions? So thank you again.